Now we're ready to start considering heteroaromatic systems, systems that contain nitrogen, oxygen, and sulfur. And the first thing that we want to do is to be able to count the number of pi electrons that that atom contributes to the pi system. The number of electrons that an atom contributes is going to depend not only on the atom type, but also on the mode of connectivity. What we're going to end up doing is taking the number of valence electrons and deciding how many of those valence electrons belong to the sp2 atomic orbitals. And by the way, we're always going to assume in these systems that every atom is sp2 hybridized if it's part of the pi system. So how many electrons contribute to the sp2 atomic orbitals? And then the number of valence electrons that are left over will be part of the pi system. Let's start with carbon, since we're familiar with that. It's going to look like this in its sp2 hybridized bonding scheme. Carbon will contribute, of its four valence electrons, three electrons to the sp2 hybridized atomic orbitals. Of the four valence electrons, then, that leaves one left over for the pi system. Every carbon atom that's going to be part of the pi system will contribute one electron to the pi system. Nitrogen can be two connected, as you can see it here in the case of pyridine. It's got two bonding connections to other atoms. Nitrogen has five valence electrons, and so it's going to end up having, in that sp2 hybridized system, since there are two bonds, two electrons that will be part of that sp2 hybridized sigma bond, and then a pair of electrons that will be making up the third of the sp2 hybridized orbitals. Altogether, four of the five electrons are going to end up being in the sp2 hybridized atomic orbitals. That leaves one left over for the pi system. An n2 nitrogen will end up contributing one electron to the pi system. What about an n3 connected nitrogen? An n3 connected nitrogen makes all three of its sp2 hybridized orbitals involved in bonding, and so the three electrons of the five valence electrons in nitrogen will be part of the sp2 system. That leaves two electrons left over for the pi system, so an n3 nitrogen contributes two pi electrons. Oxygen can be singly connected, as in a carbonyl, and it will have two lone pairs as part of the sp2 hybridized orbitals, and one sigma bond. So one electron will go in the sigma bond, and then four electrons will go in those non-bonding orbitals that are part of the sp2 system. Five of the six electrons in O1 will be part of the sp2 system, and that leaves one electron left over for the pi system. O1 contributes one electron to the pi system. O2 is an oxygen that's connected to two other atoms, and that's going to have just one lone pair in the sp2 system. Altogether, the sp2 system has two, three, four electrons. That leaves two electrons left over for the pi system, so an O2 is going to contribute two electrons to the pi system. By these rules, knowing the atom and the mode in which it's connected, we can decide how many electrons that atom is going to contribute to the pi system in a heteroaromatic system. I can tell you that these atoms don't have to be exactly a part of the pi system. For example, I will just draw. We could have a system in which there's a carbonyl that is not part of the pi system, and that oxygen is still going to be an O1 type oxygen. So something like this, for example, we have oxygen as contributing one electron for each of the O1 bound oxygens. And so even though it's not part of the cyclical system, it is part of the pi system, because every sp2 atom is adjacent to another sp2 atom, and so we need to account for all of the adjacent sp2 atoms when we count the total number of electrons in pi systems. The last point I'll make is that in these more complicated systems, which involve atoms that are not part of the formal cyclic connectivity, we don't need to worry about the Huckel rule or anything like that. All we're really interested in is how many electrons are part of this contiguous pi system.